Shendele manda la basanda rorobosuku. Retishite le miyam dokushaya. Retukusutuku. Holy God. Holy One of Israel. Rosiete kusutuku. Rotusiakande kusute lea makanda la kosu. Rashile leo sule babando le kaya. Rondeli musia te kisiki. Shondela rabaka. Sondele le bosia ba. Rotukushi amando kusai. Shondela la mosaya. Hora masana. Come in, Lord, into this place, oh God. Come in. We seek your presence, Lord. Oh. Spirit of the living God, oh. Spirit of the living God, come in, Lord. Jesus, come in, Lord. Spirit of God. Spirit of love, Spirit of peace, come into this tabernacle, come in, Lord Jesus, come in. Cleanse our hearts, Lord. Rain down, yeah. Spirit of God, Roshai. Spirit of peace, oh. Spirit of life. We're desperate, Lord, oh, Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, oh. Spirit of life, oh. Come in. shield. Come, come, oh. Come in, yeah, yeah. Ora son nele la voce. Hey, ora son del hermoso. Randiku sienta vaca. Me ashandararabuso toko. Yes, God. Ratikisito. Ratikusaka. Rotusia mandele kisilea tolaba. Rosietelimusiaba. Sondele kisite le bosua kondala la basata shandele bosu Holy One, Spirit of the Living God, rusike rutusa kateli atikula sulle abatele kusule la la le kusite le mantaka. Tu si li su li batati li kizili isu ton nekota le kaya. Tola si te mi andu asa toko. Shili hasu. Wala su li bihi si li bibu su talaka. Ho. The rain is coming. Rutuka! Rusile kateyoto la kasili la leli osule la kayo bosu teleka. The rain is coming down. Neshoyaraba. Sile kiti kusutobaka. The rain is coming down in two dimensions. For one benefit, the rain is falling in a dimension of the flesh. It comes upon the flesh to purify and to cleanse the motives of the heart. That first dimension takes you supernaturally into the next dimension. Is the dimension of the Spirit of God. When the rain falls upon a vessel that is positioned by the Spirit of God, it waters the ground. And it causes a life to continually happen and manifest the power of God. God, not flesh, but God. And I hear the Spirit of the living God said, I'm raining down upon the flesh and spirit alike, says God. But I, the Lord, want one turnout. For I hear the Spirit of the Lord say, I must be glorified. The Lord thy God must be magnified in everything that we say and that we do. If I hear the Spirit of God say, I'm coming after the motives of the heart. I'm coming after the thing that you're not saying, says God. My rain has begun to pour down, says the Lord. As my rain falls upon the flesh, it will act as an uncovering, a blind spot, and the uncovering of deceit. Chance, time after time, I've spoken, and now my rain is falling down upon all flesh, says God. The motive of your heart will be uncovered in this current season, says God. The motivation of your heart will be uncovered to you and everyone around you, says God. I, the Lord, must reign. For I hear the Spirit of the living God said, this rain we've never seen before. The intensity of the rain we've never seen or felt or experienced before. For I hear the Spirit of the living God say, behold, I do a new thing. This I'm doing, that no man would get glory but me, says the Lord. Reteko sataka. Shandilibus. I, the Lord, have spoken over this house, and I will be glorified, says the Lord. I will be glorified, says the Lord. The rain is falling down. It's coming down on me. It's raining in here. It's falling down. feel the rain, oh. This rain will cause man to resist or submit. And both will be demonstrated in this very season, says the Lord. I, the Lord, am in control of this. I can feel the rain of God. I feel the rain of God. I can feel the rain of God. It's falling down right now. Right now. The Spirit of the Living God is raining down, yeah. I feel the rain, oh, coming down, yeah. Coming down for your glory, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Yes, God. Yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Yes, it's coming down on us. Yes, Lord. My soul says yes, Lord. My soul says yes. My soul and my heart says yes to your will, Lord. Do it, God. Rotisite. Do it, God. Do it, God. Oh. Hallelujah. Yes. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Lord. My soul says yes, Father. My heart and my mind says yes, Lord. Yes, Father. Do what you will to do, my Lord. Our hearts surrender to your will. Yes, Jesus. Glory to God. Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh God, we lift you up on this day, oh Father. Oh God, we come before your presence, oh God, and we honor you, oh God. Father God, we give you another yes, oh Father, to your words, oh Father. We yield, oh God, to the rain, oh Father. Father, we yield to your word, oh God, and we commit our hearts, our minds, and souls to be obedient, oh Father, to your voice. We thank you, oh God, for what you're doing, oh Father, through us and in us, oh God, through this house, oh God, throughout this region, oh God, throughout this nation, oh Father. And Father God, we praise you, oh Father, as we stand on your word, oh God, as we embrace, be crucified through you, Christ. And we thank you for the nevertheless, oh God. Nevertheless, we live yet not through ourselves, but through your faith, oh God. Father, we honor you and we appreciate you, oh God. Father, we commit, oh God, to do your will, your way, oh Father. We thank you, oh God, that the mind that is in you, Christ Jesus, is also being us, oh Lord. And we thank you, oh God, as you purge us, oh Father. May our heart's desires, oh God, be only yours, oh Father. May our sight and our hearing be only for you and from you, oh God, in the name of Jesus. So we praise you, oh God. We're excited, oh God. We rejoice in you, oh God. And after we've done all, Father, we will continue to stand with our loins girded about with the spirit of truth, oh Lord. As you set the captives free, oh Father, we give you glory and honor and praise, oh Father, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, just raise your voice before the Lord. Give him a hallelujah. Give him a hallelujah. Come on, give him a great shout in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, a shout that you're crying out for desperation. Oh God, we thank you for the rain. We thank you for the power. We thank you for your healing virtue, oh God. We thank you for the healing stream of water. We thank you for your great dealings, oh God. In the mighty name of Jesus, oh God. We position our hearts and our mind and our soul. We say, God, have your way in the mighty name of Jesus. Do whatever you need to do through us and in us, oh God. We said, pluck it out, God. Oh God, we want to be that one, Father God. Birthed in that place where you call us into. In the mighty name of Jesus, standing righteous and holy and bold before you, oh God. Oh God, we say, God, in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh Father God, we are ready to go up. We are ready to go up. We are ready to go up. We are ready to go higher. And higher heights and deeper depths. We're ready in intercession. We're ready to preach your word. We're ready to stand bold before you, oh God. We're ready to obey. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. And the Lord is with a heart, a desperate heart. Desperate for him. That is what he's seeking. The Lord said, I'm seeking those ones that are desperate. And those the ones gonna receive the power in his spirit to go out to do his mighty work. He's one of that one that is bold and righteous, fearless. There's a great calling here on earth. And the Lord is calling his people to do mighty work. And Father God, we will not let you down because of what you did for us and our families. Oh Father God, you brought much healing in our families. We thank you for the great conversion, oh God. We thank you for salvation that you're bringing them, Father God, out of the deep dump, Father God, into the mighty hope, oh God, in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, Father God, that you're bringing them out of the wilderness in Jesus' mighty name. And for that, tonight, today, we proclaim your name. We worship you in spirit and in truth, oh God. We worship him. Come on, give him a hallelujah. Hallelujah! 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 La bocciante le bacchante, la bocciante le bacchata, la rebiante chi ando la bocca, la rebiante ando con la bacca, e ne ande al bacchatiasso, e con maie! God. Let him do what he needs to do through you. Let him do that thing that he needs to do to bring you up. I tell you, Andrea, I can say from experience, don't fight against him. Don't fight against him. Let him do what he needs to do. Let him do what he needs to do. Let him do it. I got to a point where I said, Lord, I'm tired of fighting against you. And for several months, I've been on my knees, repenting. He opened my eyes to see me. Where I thought I was okay. Where I thought that many was against me. They were wrong and I was right. I didn't know that I was holding offense in my heart. Selling offense. Unforgiveness. I didn't know it. But I say we have a praying leaders. Now that I know that she was on her knees. Interceding. Let him do it. Let him do it. Let him do it. Let him do it. And so, Father, we surrender our hearts today. And we repent before you. Do what you need to do, oh God. We surrender our hearts before you. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, be exalted God, be high and lifted up, oh God, we praise your name, Jesus, Jesus, hallelujah, you're God alone, you're God alone, the Most High God.
Presence. Welcome into his presence. Hallelujah, saints. Welcome into the presence of the Lord. Welcome into the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because we know he's here. Hallelujah. So we're going to lift him up. We're going to give him the praise. And we're going to declare and decree some things in the atmosphere and see the change today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because it's the best day of our lives today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm excited and I'm expecting. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah.
The best day of my life.
The best day.
And today,
the best day of my life.
Jesus said it.
Jesus said,
I believe it.
I believe
today is
the best day of my life.
Jesus said it.
Jesus said,
I believe it.
I believe
that today
is the best day of my life.
Explain. His name. Say there is power.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
So much power in.
Power in your name.
There is power in your name.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
So much power in.
Power in your name.
Say things change when we call your name.
Things change when we call you Jesus.
Things change.
Things change when we call.
Oh
you Jesus,
oh my God,
things change
situation have to shift when you call his name.
Everything has to change.
Your circumstances have to shift when you call his name.
Everything has to change.
Everything has to change, and it will change.
Everything has to change.
Everything has to change. It must change.
Everything has to change.
Everything has to change, and it will change.
Everything has to change.
Everything has to change. It must change.
Everything has to change.
Everything has to change. And it will change.
Say,
tell me who can stand before us when we call on that name. Tell me who can stand.
Keep praying, I will keep fasting.
display your image, Lord. Yeah. We'll display your heart, Lord. Yeah. That we can help you draw the soul, Lord. Yeah. We're ready to move, Lord. Yeah. I won't stop, Lord, until you see you, Jesus. Oh, yeah.
But I'm ready.
Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. We're going to get ready to take up our offering at this time. If you need an offering envelope, please raise your hands and the gatekeepers will assist you.
Amen. As a church, united as one, we are ready. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm just here to remind you that this is the day that the Lord has made. And it's also the day, the first Sunday of our love offering. Amen. In the pink envelopes. So ushers, don't forget to pass out. Ushers. Watchmen, don't forget to pass out the pink envelopes. And the pink envelopes is a love offering where we show forth our love to our apostles. Amen. For what they contribute in our life, for what they give in our life, for what they speak in our life, for the truth that's on them become the truth in us. Amen.
Hands of the gatekeepers. Incorporated, a house of refuge. Announcements for Sunday, January 8th, 2023. This coming Thursday, January 12th, will be Pastor Mariah's birthday. Happy birthday, Pastor Mariah. We here at Forever Praise Ministries love you. Amen. Next Sunday, January 15th, the new members class will be held from 9:30 to 10:30 a.m. in the meeting room. For any questions, see Pastor Mariah. Also, Good Shepherd's Day will be on Sunday, January 15th. It's a time where we bless our pastors with household items. A list of items are at the Welcome Center and also on our website at www.foreverpraiseministries.org. For questions, see Prophetess Tony. Our men's fellowship will be on Saturday, January 21st from 1:30 p.m. to 3 p.m. here at the church. For any questions, see Pastor Darrell Black. The Glorious Praise Dance Ministry is currently in the process of purchasing new flags. We need your help to reach our goal, and we're asking everyone to sow a $20 seed. We thank you in advance for your love and support. Please see Pastor Tony with donations. We are entering into our 16th year church anniversary, which means we have the pleasure to sow into it. Our assessments per member is $200. If you have any questions, please see Elder Andrea. And our Sunday School Lessons for Life is held every Sunday at 9:30 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall, inviting everyone to come out to study and learn God's Word. For any questions, see Elder Jean. Amen. Those are our announcements.
dancers ready? Amen. Let us receive Glorious Praise Dance Ministry, followed by our Apostle Pastor Tony Lo Shavo. Amen.
So now that we've walked around by faith, let's release the glory of the Lord in this place. Hallelujah. Anybody want the glory of the Lord in this place? Come on, say, God, we want your glory. Come on, open up your mouths and say, God, we want your glory. Come on, tell them, God, we want your glory. We want your manifested presence, your power. Come on, petition the Lord for his glory in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless your name, God.
Alarabushanda. Rotusia tamaka. Shandele Mosaya. Hallelujah. Shandele Mosanda. Glory to God. Yes, Father. Holy One of Israel, we honor your presence. You're such a mighty God. Nothing compares to that great name. We submit and we humble our hearts to you completely. For it's all about you, Jesus. Unveil to us the mystery of blindness, Father. Rosia topokusa. It's a mystery. To some of our blindness, we can't see. Rutoka. And it takes the Spirit of God to unveil the blindness and the motives of the heart. It takes God. There is an unveiling that is happening in the realm of the Spirit. And it is not controlled by man or flesh. It's a dealing of the heart that can only come through by God. You can't control it. You can't associate yourself with people, places, or things to get to this place. It must be a connection with God. Point, some of us have realized that we have no real connection, because the Bible tells us that the Spirit of God brings life. There is nothing dead in God, there's no question, but there is a mystery of your madness, and only the Spirit of truth, the Spirit of the living God, is right at your door. He's knocking. To give God access to your wounds, to your madness, to your situation, you must give him a yes. And let me tell you, this yes can't be surfaced. It's not something that sits at the top that is altered by circumstances. When a real yes from God brings power, it brings endurance and empowerment. It gives you the strength to face not them, but you. Some of us are worried about facing man. But the real issue is looking at yourself in the mirror and seeing all of the problems that lies within my heart, all of the issues that lies within my mind. The crying is in my soul. It is a mystery, not to you, to God, but to you. God knows everything, but right now you are in a mysterious state because you have been deceived by the devil. You have been deceived by the care of the life. You have been deceived by the motive. And only God can come. He's greater than the songs that we sing. He
He's greater than everything that I can preach. He's uncontainable. You can't contain him. You can't max him out. It's impossible for him to be maxed out. But he can take you to the depth of his love. He can take you to the heights of who he is. But although you are still limited, look, you are limited. Why? Because you can never go beyond God. You can never go beyond what you are given. Even if you desire it, you can only go as far as God allotted for you to go. So this is the hour that I hear the Spirit of the living God say, I am at your door. He called the Ramosha. I'm about to unveil the mystery of your heart. I'm about to reveal the mystery to your madness. But you first must count the cost. The Bible tells us that we've got to count the cost. That means that you must consider the things that you've got to go through, the things that you must look at. The battles that you must win within the heart is not an outward battle, it's an inward battle. This battle is in your heart, although it's raging outside of you. But the major determining factor of how deep a battle is how your heart sees this battle. But I come to tell you that this battle is not yours. This battle is the Lord. But you gotta cease your battle within yourself. You are in battle with God. There is a conflict of the soul. Rosite limakaya. That is also a mystery to you, but not to God. Most of us can't look at ourselves and say how far I'm willing to go for God when you're afraid, when you are wounded, when you are oppressed. You don't know the distance that you will take for God. And you can only have some idea of how far you'll go with the things that you love, like your wife or your husband, your children, your church. But if there is 25%, 1%, any percentage of a question in your heart, you will eventually become powerless. Rotiko sata. If inside of you is not 100% sure that you want to go the distance with God, you'll be limited on this earth. That means you'll do according to what your flesh or your feelings or your emotions would dictate. It's called a cycle. You'll continue to recycle. Because you are not 100% persuaded to serve God. People are not your issue, God is. Why? Because you serve God according to your love and trust in God. If there's a lack in trust in God, there will be a lack in your dealings and connected relationally on this earth. But you will have the ability to go deep with man on this earth when you go deep in God. Otherwise, you will be very limited and powerless over the situations that you're in. I said all that to say, for 3 weeks, I've been praying for this day. And today consists of an invitation to repentance and forgiveness. The Lord said to me, He said, invite them to come to me. And for 3 weeks, literally, I've been reading John, the 8th chapter, wanting to understand exactly what God is saying in this present season out of that book. And so as I begin to take my notes, glory to God, the Lord said, I'm inviting the man by accusations. Rosito Pocosata. In adultery, according to John the 8th chapter, the Bible tells us that it was, in my words, a setup for her. The Bible tells us that the scribes and the Sadducees had come to the synagogue where Jesus was preaching and teaching. And because the heart of the scribes and the Pharisees were not with God, they sought to set him up, says the Bible, to see if they can accuse him. And the Bible tells us that they brought the woman in a synagogue and placed her in the middle of the church. So it would be maybe in the right in the center here. And they said to Jesus, they said, Jesus, this woman was caught in the very act of adultery. How will you handle this situation? Now, what was profoundly revealed to me was to repent, forgive, or turn away from her adultery. The only reason she was in the church was because the scribes and the Pharisees had caught her and brought her before Jesus. So Jesus looked down and he began to write on the ground as the scribes and the Pharisees asked him, what are you going to do about this? And he said to them, ye who is without sin, cast the first stone. And as he looked up and told him that, he began to write. And the Bible tells us from the oldest to the youngest, they began to leave the synagogue where there was no one there but the woman that was caught in adultery and Jesus. And the Bible tells us that she looked at him as he looked at her and said, where is your accusers? Where are they? He said, I don't see them, do you? She said, no, I don't see them either. He said, look, I don't condemn you. Believe and go and sin no more. And so as I looked at that, the accuser brought her into the place where Jesus was, thinking that they were going to catch him. But it was her day of healing and deliverance. It was a divine setup. But the accuser got to accuse you. The hater got to hate on you. They got to bring you to the place that you are in the vicinity of God, where God can talk to you.
was looking in, religion would tell you that you gotta be ready, but she wasn't ready. For God, he was ready for her. So she was at a point that she had to make a decision. He said, I'm not condemning you. I don't even care about your sin right now. It's not about what you've done. It's about what you need to do. I brought you here to give you a chance. He said, now leave my presence, but don't do what got you into the act of adultery anymore. So today is a day that he is inviting us in. He's not looking at your sin. He's giving you an invitation. Now let me tell you about this kind of invitation. When we realize that I was set up by my enemy, hear me. She was set up. But it wasn't even about her. There was a bigger picture. It was about her soul. I'm sorry, it wasn't about Jesus. But they made it about Jesus. But it was really about her. And so I began to look at everything that we're going through is supposed to take us into the presence of God. The accuser of the brethren is here. But if you stay where you need to be, Jesus will come and meet you where you are. So I saw that she didn't pray. The Bible doesn't indicate that she was repentant. She was ready to be forgiven. She was a pawn for Jesus' accuser, but they had to find someone that was in the will of God, hear me, ready to be released. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us that she turned away, but he gave her the opportunity. The opportunity came to her. Her situations, her sins brought her to Jesus. And so I begin to ponder on that and begin to wonder what she must have done. She either repented afterwards and start to work on herself and stop sinning, or she went back and continued to sin. But God allows us to know when he's ready for you. And he doesn't come all the time when you're on your knees praying and asking for him to come. He'll come right in the midst of your sin, telling you that you need to come. So this is the hour that God is not looking at your sin. He's looking at your future, and he's giving you the opportunity to turn and come to him. He'll strengthen you. He will strengthen you. The Bible did not say that she was crying out and tired of her sin. But it was clear that it was a setup. But he's got to use what you choose. He's got to use what you're bound with. He's got to use what's overwhelming your mind and your desires. He's got to use it. Those are the things that the enemy will use, but they bring you right to God. I want you to listen. I'm going to amplify this. I
because sometimes it's hard for religious people to see if I don't read the scripture. So I'm going to read it, and I'm going to go to my next. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives early in the morning. He came back into the temple court, and all the people were coming to him. He sat down and began teaching them. Now the scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. They made her stand in the center of the church. So that's humiliation, right? She was humiliated. But guess what? It was in the plan of God for her to be humiliated. And then he gave her the opportunity to what? Forgive everything that had just happened to her. Listen. They made her stand in the center of the court. And they said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in the very act of adultery. Now in the law of Moses commanded us to stone such a woman to death." So her sin was worthy unto death. And Jesus was not even concerned of the magnitude of her sin. So what do you say to do with her? What is your sentence? This is what Moses is saying. What are you saying? This is what Moses said to do. Jesus, what are you? They wanted to accuse him, but she was a pawn. They said this to test him, hoping that they will have grounds for accusing him. So they had to accuse her to get to him. I want you to understand. But Jesus stooped down and began writing on the ground with his finger. However, when they persisted in questioning him, he straightened up and said, "He who is without any sin among you, let him be the first to throw a stone at her." Then he stooped down again and started writing on the ground. They listened to his reply, and they began to go out one by one, starting with the oldest ones, until he was left alone with the woman standing there before him, empty, naked, but with a divine opportunity in the center of the court. Straightening up, Jesus said to her, "Woman, where are they?" So I liken that into where you are right now. You're right in the center of your struggle. You know what you're doing. God knows what you're doing. So right now is not even about that. It's about what God wants to do with you. That's the love of God. And there are divine seasons and times and opportunity that we must seize. When God gives those times when he comes and he allow a setup or a plan, it's very, very vital that we do what God wants us to do. Or guess what? It's going to get worse. Why? Because God doesn't waste his time. He doesn't just allow things to happen, and especially when he allowed you, but he chose to step in your situation when you are sinning against him. But the Bible tells us in Psalms 103, said, "I remove your transgression as far as the east is from the west." He removes. He's willing to overlook. But you gotta make yourself ready for him when he's ready for you. It's a setup. It's a divine setup. He asked her, did no one condemn you? She answered, no one, Lord. And Jesus said, I do not condemn you either. Then he said, go. Go from now on, sin no more. That's what he said, from now on. From this point where I'm coming to you, I'm giving you the opportunity to turn away from what you're doing. The opportunity is today. You've got to understand when God is calling you. You got to understand that he must get into or allow attacks to happen to bring you in the center of the court. It took your accusers. It's taking your haters. It's taking everybody that backstabbed you. It's taking your heart's desires to bring you to God. So with that point, I come to tell you that your invitation to God is today. Now I want everyone, now the month of January is always geared to that matters, the depths and the issues of the heart. Ever since we've been in ministry, January is the month that God unveils the mystery of your heart to you. He gives us the opportunity, and we must seize it. We got to understand that you think you're getting yourself ready to be right. No, it's not that. You better see when he's ready for you. Now, my story is not like yours. Now, I was in sin when he called me. I was in the night, and you know my story. So I did not pray. I understand the woman that was accused. I wasn't prayerful. I was just setting my heart to continue to sin, and God came in my house and called me in the midst of my high. And he wants to make it plain to you that he's talking to you. So situations will occur, things will happen to get your attention, and it's only to get you in the center of the court. You don't need to get yourself ready. God gets you ready. There's no preparation that you can do to get you. You don't even know what you need. You've been so bound with sin and overcome by the cares of the... You can pray, but you can only pray from that soulish realm. So as I looked at this story, I understood that she needed help. She needed someone to accuse her. She needed to be caught. She wouldn't have come to Jesus. He went and got her. He called someone to accuse her. Bring her right here. Bring her here. See, they were used by God. Now, religious people said that was the devil, was God, it was a setup. Because I believe that she had a lot to lose had she not heard from God that day. Glory to God. So as your prophet, to you and say, when you make up your mind today, you'll have the strength to repent. You don't have it yet. You need to be endowed. You need to know that you're being forgiven to forgive others. You need the knowledge of forgiveness from the Father. Now, our offense comes from people, but ultimately, I forgive you because I love God. I can forgive you because I've been forgiven by God with every sin that was in. So when you know you've been forgiven, you can forgive others. So that was the woman that was caught in the act of adultery. She had to know that she was forgiven. She had to know that it was God to turn her away and desire something different. It's a strategy of the Spirit. It's a supernatural strategy. Controlled by God, not the devil. Today is your opportunity. Today is your day. So guess what? You don't even have to look at how hard it's going to be to stop. Because God's going to do it when you seize this moment. You got to say yes to God. You've got to be willing to go with God today. So he flipped it. There's no one in here accusing you right now, although you're wrong. He said, tell him there's no accuser. He said, I don't condemn you. I'm not accusing you today. Today you're going to receive atonement. Even though you're doing what you're doing today for this house, it's a day that God will strengthen you to sin no more. Glory to God. And some of us say, well, I'm not sinning. I'm not drinking. I'm not drugging. I'm not sleeping around. I'm not going to the bars. But you're hating. You're jealous and you're envy. You're fearful. You're angry. You're halted between two opinions. The Bible says anything outside of faith is sin. So whatever idol is in your heart, whatever you have before God is a sin. You may not be doing, but you're backbiting and you're slandering. Your motive of what you're doing has been selfishly motivated by your feelings and your emotion. You are emotional motivated. There's no big sin, no little sin. Sin is sin. No one's accusing you. This is an invitation that will take you to your next step of deliverance. But you gotta say yes. You gotta be willing to go the distance with God, for God, for the glory. See, most of our serving is not unto God. If it was, you wouldn't have the attitude you have now. You are socially motivated by man. Your heart is centered around the wrong things to motivate you. And you're not motivated by God. But this is the day that no one's here to accuse you. Glory to God. that this is the day to make it right. I want you to listen. 2 Corinthians 7 chapter. For even when we arrived in Macedonia, our bodies had no rest, but we were oppressed at every turn, conflicts and disputes without fears and dread within. But God, who comforts and encourages the depressed and the disquieted, comforted us by the arrival of Titus, a messenger. And not only by his arrival, but also by his account of the encouragement which he received in regard to you. He told us about your longing for us, your mourning over sin, and how eagerly you took my part and supported me so that I rejoiced even more. For even though I did grieve you with my letter, I do not regret it now. Though I did regret it, for I see that the letter hurt you, though only for a little while. Yet I am glad, not because you were hurt and made sorrow, but because your sorrow led to repentance and you turned back to God. And so at this point that we see that Paul was writing a letter and he was correcting the church of Corinth. And some of them got really offended and he said, I'm sorry that you are offended that my letter hurt you. Why? Because the only thing that can correct a problem is the Spirit of truth. So he had to send the letter to the church to rebuke them and tell them the truth. But he can't be motivated by their emotion if they're going to like him or not. When you are on the front line, you cannot be motivated by someone's feelings because you're afraid that they're not going to like you. You're afraid that they won't accept you. They didn't accept Jesus. They lied on Jesus. They rejected the prophets before you. So he said, care not that man hate you. But you got to tell the truth. The truth is the only thing that makes anybody free. You will not get free by someone tickling, coming and pacifying you. The devil is a lie. I don't pacify devils. And I definitely don't pacify something that's killing you, that's going to kill your generation, kill your seed, kill your thoughts. The devil, I'm going to attack that spirit with truth. Is to love the truth. To love God is to be bold and sincere about not only your deliverance, but the deliverance of people that you're covering and you're praying. You don't love me if you can't tell me the truth. You can't war for me if you can't war in truth. You cannot have my back if you cannot take truth. Why? Because the moment your feelings are hurt, you're going to dwindle out, turn your back, because if 20% of you is offended, then it blocks 100% of your covering. A little leaven leavened your lump. So, okay, I'm going to give you a revelation. If Sister Paige is offended with me 20%, she'll stop seeing me. She'll stop sensing me. And say if she was praying for me up on the wall,
standing in the gap. And then the moment I violated her and she took on the fence, guess what happened? She no longer sense and can war in the spirit for me. Although that my offense, her offense with me is regarding truth. And I had to correct her, and she knows it's true. But the moment she offends God by being offended with me, God will not deal with her about me until she gets her heart right so she can cover me. And so I had a dream this morning in the wee hours. And I was somewhere, and all the church people, I know who they were that was standing around me. And a situation had occurred against me. And so there were two men that were standing, but I was in a situation, and I looked up and said, do they see what's happening to me? I looked. And so one man ran straight, quick, but the second man looked. And the Lord showed me 20% of his offense caused him to not have a sensitivity that I needed help. And then he helped afterwards. But the one ran quickly, but the second one had a delayed response to help me because of the offense. And so I sat up and I began to look up. And then that situation began to play out. And so the Lord spoke to me. And he said, tell your people, 20% offense shuts them down 100%. When that scripture says a little leaven leavens your whole lump, you'll become blocked. There is a block that will come up. And you will not have the sensitivity to the person that you are and called to help, that you called to pray for, because you shut God's voice down to you when you get offended. And so we're not able to be effective spiritually because there's a shutdown in the realm of the spirit. And so let me go further. If you continue to see, then your sight is from a dark gate. Because God stops dealing with you. He said, forgive that you will be forgiven. So when we shut down, it causes God to step back. That's why you stop hearing, you stop sensing, you're not dreaming, you're not feeling, you're mixed up with your signals. The prophetic anointing is halted, or it will come out contaminated. Unless you seize this opportunity that is before you. Or you 100% shut down. How do I know I'm shut down? I don't have that drive to do. You lose your drive. You lose your gift. How can you be a prophet or an intercessor in the house if you don't ever feel no one? You never sense anyone. And over the last few weeks, I had people that's not even on the prayer team come and telling me what they're sensing God is saying, and they've been right on. So there's somewhere someone is dropping the ball, because intercession is falling on people that are not called or put in position to pray. Someone else is praying on your behalf. One after another. And they will be considered immature because they don't have a position. But God will use anybody that he anoints. So in this season, God is anointing people. He's raising them up. And he's going to cause them to be able to stand and make
at you. You break in the head when you are offended. And so the Bible says that we can't. We cannot move forward until you what? Have godly sorrow in your heart to turn you away from your sin. Yet I am glad not because you were hurt, but made sorry. For godly sorrow that is in accord with the will of God. Hear this. Godly sorrow that is in accord with the will of God produces a repentance without regret. So you hear that? If I am made sorry the right way, guess what it's going to produce? You only have to go and ask for prayer. It's going to open your heart and take you to repentance. You don't have to say, God, help me to repent. That means you're not ready to repent. You have to be made sorry for what has happened. It will lead you to the door of repentance, and it comes automatic. And that's what a hard heart is, someone that's got an attitude that's not changing. Why? Because you're not sorry. So I don't expect no one to repent when you're not sorry. It's impossible. You cannot repent until you're sorry. So don't go to somebody and say, I'm sorry, when you know you're not. That's madness. It's madness to say, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, and you know you're not. You're going to go home and you're going to think about what they've done to you. You're going to come to church day after day. You're going to walk past them and not say, you're not sorry. And you know what? You're not in the vicinity of repentance or forgiveness. It said godly sorrow that is in accord with the will of God. That means doing the right way. Doing it right, not saying, I'm sorry, you're not. Produces a repentance without regret. You don't have any regrets. You're not embarrassed. Leading to salvation. You hear that? Sorry, repentance, then salvation. That means then I'm able to be redeemed. I'm able to be delivered. The hand of God is able to come down and get me. I am in the center of the court. It says, for you can look back and see what an earnest, is an authentic concern this godly sorrow has. But you see the authenticity of it. You know that it's real. Everybody around you know that it's real. You can feel it. It's an authentic concern with godly sorrow has produced in you. What vindication of yourselves against charges that you tolerate sin. What indignation at sin. What fear of offending God. What longing for righteousness and justice. What passion to what is right. What readiness to punish those who sin and those who tolerate sin. At every point, you have proved yourself to be innocent in this matter, but you gotta be sorry first, then you'll become innocent in the matter. Any part of you and I that is not surrendered, this is the principles I live by. This is how I got delivered. This is the word that God spoke to me many years ago and said, what do you really want? That's what he's saying. So when the woman that was caught in adultery, that was a moment to see what she really wanted. It was ultimately her choice. Are you going to go and sin no more? Are you going to go and continue to sin? Rosite la makaya. Rosile mandalako. No one's accusing you. No one's here but God. Although you know, we know where we are. But the Lord is ready to forgive it. He's ready to release you. At every point,
you have proved yourself to be innocent in the matter. So even though I wrote to you as I did, it was not for the sake of the offender, nor for the sake of the one offended, but in order to make evident to you before God how earnestly you do care for us. So it says that this decision is based on how much you really care and your willingness to accept our authority. So he was writing to them. He said, okay, how you respond will show me how you're willing to accept the people who have authority over you. So it's not just about you. It's about accepting the one who's called to tell you the truth. Even though you're mad at them, it affects hearing your leader. It will hinder and alter the voice of God to you. So it's more than just that. The next step, you can't accept and trust anyone in authority if you don't make this next step. I'm going to say it again before we pray. Glory to God. So even though I wrote to you as I did, it was not for the sake of the offender, nor for the sake of the one offended, but in order to make evident to you before God how earnestly you do care for us and your willingness to accept our authority. So what's that saying is, what you do today will show you how much you accept who I am to you. That's what Paul's letter was. Your next step will see, you will see. Because you can't go any further. You can't trust any set leader in your life if you don't make this step. It is for this reason that we are comforted and now encouraged. So this step brings comfort and encouragement. That's why you're depressed. You're depressed and you're oppressed because somewhere you stopped receiving the spirit of life. This Bible right here, when I was depressed, I looked up everything I was going through in the concordance and I chose to believe it. I had nothing but my hope in God. I was hopeless, but I knew that my last resort to healing was choosing to believe it and not feel it. See, when you're emotional, it's hard to feel that this Bible is going to work to you, for you, because you're emotionally bound by your situation, so you're not going to feel good. Right feels wrong, wrong feels right. But when you stay on this word and you choose to believe and not feel it, feeling it will come after you spend time with applying it. Glory to God. And then you'll go to encouragement. It will come. Stand on your feet. This is an invitation. Randelio Kosaya. The accuser of the brethren came. But it was a setup. This next step is a determining step to see how far you want to go for God. It's not about what you feel and what you want, never. It has nothing to do with you. Although you're involved in the big picture, God needs you. It's about your seed, seed. It's about the seed, the people that you call to cover and minister to. It's about God. So I tell you again, there's no one here accusing you. Glory to God. Jesus is not even condemning you. This is an opportunity for you to turn to God. You may not be ready. It has nothing to do with you ready. He's ready for you. I want you to understand something. You're not ready. He's ready. You get in more trouble by not coming when he's ready than when you're ready. He's not waiting on you. There is a demand in the realm of the spirit, and everything lies upon your yes. Today is determining if you're here, then this word is for you. How far are you willing to go for God? There's no one here but Jesus. And the altar is open for you. If you desire to shift, you could come before God. There's no one here but you and God. No one's here. He's really to forgive you and release you from your sin. For your glory, Lord. For your glory, Lord. For your glory. Oh, Roshandele Bokusuku. Yes, God. Rosniko Basata. We're here, Lord. Holy God, Holy God, we're here, God, and we're bearing our hearts before you. Shende kusutu. My heart is made ready. Urado satani. Come on, talk to God. Glory, come on, talk to him as you and God. This is the beginning of your shift. This is the beginning of your shift. Father, you made it plain. You called us and we're answering, God. Father, we're sorry for the things that we've done, oh God. We ask that you will forgive us, oh God. For the even the sins is in my heart, oh God, oh God, oh God. Here I am. All of me. And I say to you, glory to God. There's no one here to condemn you. Go. From now on, sin no more, says the Lord. You may go in peace. Rosikotama. Rosutok. Hallelujah, Jesus. Here I am, Lord. Oh. Hallelujah, Jesus. Rende kusinda sundele busuto holy garabasha rotikusia bakala rende kishile lukusura bakala holy holy rutsu. There's fire. Stand in the middle, prophet. Stand. Rusuk. There will be like a fire on your mouth. Rusuk utilakandele kusu. The prophet must speak in this hour. For I hear the spirit of the living God say, you will be put in many situations that many must hear the truth of God's word. For I hear the Lord say unto you that I open your eyes into this next dimension of truth. There is one requirement of continual sight is for you to keep your heart right, even in situations that will involve you, says God. For I hear the Lord say unto you that there will be situations that can cause you to be offended according to the old man. But this new man can take every hit and prophesy right in the midst of a hit. For I hear the Lord say, you have entered into a war zone. And there will be many situations that you will be standing and be part of the matter that's happening. But you will stand and say what God is saying. To redirect the manner, says God. He told me to tell you that it will be him. It's not the devil. But I pray that the fire of God will consume you. And that you will remain in this place. Because a lot of people's lives will cling to the truth in this season. So I hear the spirit of the living God say to you that I am charging you this day to speak truth. You told God, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I'll say whatever you need me to say. Your talk to God has gotten his attention in a way that has never had. It opened your eyes. It opened your spirit. And now you're ready to go. Says, go in peace, says God. Go in peace. Rutoka! Hi! Rasule kandele kusata. Mandele kusi le kusota laka. Rondele kusaya rabako. Shundele bosa. Prophet Kevin, come in the center. Rosiliko. Lift your hands before God. You're free, says the Lord. No longer will your thoughts be hijacked. No longer will you be emotionally driven. You're ready to take your next step for the kingdom of God. For I see a situation where you will be before your parents. This is the time that you must tell them the truth. You must say everything you need to say to your mother. You must say everything that you need to say to your father. You must say everything that you need to say to your children, says God. The spirit of truth will fill your heart, that you will passionately desire them to be delivered. If I hear the Lord say that I'm going to begin to take you into situations that you were blinded to because you weren't ready to see. But now you are ready to see what you need to see to come against these generational powers. You have entered into a time of warfare. You are in battle for your family, says God. But I hear the Lord say, fear not, look not at their faces. Rejection can no longer be a part of who you are. He's moving that spirit of rejection from you. And he's giving you true identity in his love by his power. Is happening just like that. Welcome into your new place. Go in peace. Rende kusata. Shandile bukusu. Brittany Johnson, come stand in front. Rasaye boku. When Moses told God, send my brother Aaron, because he had a stammer in his tongue. He had all these inner fears and insecurities that he didn't think he was suitable for God to use him, because he felt that he didn't have eloquent speech. And so the Bible tells us that God's anger kindled against Moses because he was afraid. And so the Lord took Moses through the plagues, and he told Moses to go tell Pharaoh to let my people go. But the Bible also says that he was going to harden the heart of Pharaoh. And Pharaoh was not going to let the people go, but he wanted Moses to keep going back. And so as every time he went back, he had to declare a curse, but he had to live through the curse. Moses made it through the curse, and so will you. But the difference between you will not miss the promised land. And the fears and the things that you have not uttered, God heard them. Your tongue will now be fluent. You don't have to be afraid to speak and say anymore. Your tongue has been released, says God.
Hey! You had a stammering tongue,
but you don't have it anymore. Go in peace. Glory to God. Randele bukusto. Mashandele bus. Glory. Shonda and Tiffany, come stand in front of me. Pastor Shonda and Tiffany. Glorious Pastor. Stand right there. Stop. Prophet of God. Chorus. I want you to face one another, and I want you to say this to her, Shonda. He did it for me. He's going to do it for you. It's been done. I'm healed, and so are you. The same declaration that was made over you, make it over her. Because the same results that you got, she shall get it too. Now hug her and tell her the goodness of God. Rosandele Bokusa. Randele Bosata. Oh. Horasoto. Shindekusa. Same miracles. Same miracles. Same signs. Same wonder. You shall see the salvation of God. You will see the hand of God. You will know that there is a balm in Gilead. The great I am is visiting you. Your first sign will be you will never have pain in your legs. In your legs, the pain in your back, the pain that runs up and down your body, you will know that God is real this day. It will only be a memory to testify. You will only have testimonies to testify. Every diagnosis will turn into a testimony. He continues to do it for her. So shall it be unto you. Go in peace. Go in peace. Randele Kusa. Go. That means go with God. Nese, go with peace. Go with God. Now let me tell you, Tiffany. The doctors kept coming up with something with her. She came to someone that believed God, her pastor. I declared the word of God in her hearing, even when she wanted to, because of one after another. I said, go on to the doctor, let him see. They're going to see. She defied. Defied everything they said. Every condition they claimed, God reversed it. Supernaturally. In your only thing that you need to do is keep dancing. Hey, that's where the oil flow. Rotoka. If you would have stopped dancing, that sickness would have already overtaken you. But the anointing caused the oil to continue to flow. It's been a test. And you've been with God. In your weakness, He was with you. But you proved to God that you were going to stay with Him. God knows that you're going to stay. You're not going to leave Him. So benefits are coming your way. Glory to God. Benefits. Glory to God. Father, we honor you. We honor you, God. We honor you, God. We thank you for this opportunity you've given us. You drew us by our own weaknesses, our own sin. It caused you to come to us. You've given us all the opportunity, oh God, to turn our hearts to you. Thank you. This day was declared in heaven before the foundations of this earth. It was. Now it's been established. You can forgive now. Glory to God. You can move forward. You made the decision to follow God. Now He's going to do the rest. And Father, I thank you for giving us the strength to trust you. I ask that you will release a fresh, lift your hands in this place and a fresh anointing. Fresh anointing. Freshness. Thank you for reigning on. Thank you for everything that you're doing and will continue to do. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your word. We will hide it so deep in our hearts that we will not sin against you, Lord. But Father, as we leave this place, we'll never from your presence. I ask you that you will keep us until we meet again. In Jesus' name. You are dismissed. Hug and love your neighbor. Amen. Welcome into your new season. No one's accusing you. That's over. You can say bye-bye to your past. You can say bye-bye to it. Hey! It's over! Glory! Amen. Someone's here for the first time. Anyone here for the first time? Raise your hand. I know. Hi, how are you? What's your name? Tiffany, you look familiar. Hi. Okay, anyone else? Amen. Hug and love your neighbor. Don't forget what God said today. Oh, I'm sorry. Hi, Carmen. Thank you for coming. God bless you. Amen. God bless you.